Everyone, glad that you are here to worship with us, those of you that are here and those that are joining us online. We begin a new year this morning, and while we don't know what 2023 has in store for us, we know that Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and He is on the throne, and so no matter what is waiting for us in this new year, we know that He's with us, and we have come today to just worship and praise Him. If you're visiting with us this morning for the first time, please just fill out one of the connection cards and turn it into our guest center. We got a little gift that we'd like to give you. Just great to be together this morning and worship. Would you be standing with me this morning, and we're going to just open in prayer and then praise the name of Jesus. Father, we just thank You for just this new day that we have in You. A new year, and Father, we know that You love us and that You will guide us and walk with us. Thank You for all the blessings that You have given us, even through difficult times this past year, and just thank You for Your hand and Your leading in our lives as we start a new year this morning. And so we just want to lift up and praise the name of Your Son, Jesus, and it's in His name we pray. Amen.
Blessed be Your name in the land that is plentiful, where Your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be Your name. Blessed be Your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be Your name. Blessing You pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name. We'll be right back.
I am sure that many of us can look back at 2022 and say, there were things that were taken away. And I'm sure that there's others that can say, praise you, God. Because when we can sit there and look at what it is that we have gone through, I can guarantee you there's somebody that's gone through something worse. And I can't think of another person who has gone through more than anyone else than Jesus, because he says it will have happened to me first before anyone else. So when we go through a lot of bad things in life, we can say, Lord, I am going through some stuff. It hurts. I don't like it. There's pain. It's uncomfortable. But you are still God. And I praise your name because I know how this story ends. So this next song, 10,000 Reasons, there's plenty of them.
Song again, whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Lift your voice. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. Worship your holy name.
You may be seated this morning.
To
Good morning, church, and Happy New Year. I'm Tim Holloway. I'm a relatively new member, so you can bear with me. I've been asked to do today's communion meditation. So I'd like to start off with the importance of communion. In John 6, 53 and 54, Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up in the last day." So the sacraments are very important. When we take the communion, we remember Jesus. And after our baptism, which is another sacrament we're to take place in, it says we're a new person, but we're born a baby. And it's empty inside. And the Bible tells us that if you don't fill that with something, it'll get filled with demons. And so we have to go through that process. And in Romans 12, 2, it says, "And be not conformed to the world, but rather be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and show you as the perfect will of God." And I like to look at that as that time is kind of transformational. In the Greek means metamorphed. And when we think of metamorphism, we think of that little ugly caterpillar that's maybe kind of, you look at it and it's almost disgusting, and it weaves itself into a cocoon, and there's a big struggle that goes on in there, and it's transformed or metamorphed into a beautiful butterfly. Well, our Christian walk is very similar to that. And it tells us in the Bible that, in Matthew, he answered, said, "It is written, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." So, well, unlike the butterfly who is transformed inside a cocoon that nobody sees, ours is clear and translucent so people can see through it. And they watch as we struggle and we emerge from that cocoon of transition and metamorphosis. And it's hard. And we have backsliding, and sometimes things don't go exactly the way we want it to do, but we are continually being metamorphed or transformed. And in the end, in the final end, when the beautiful butterfly emerges, that's the day that Christ comes again. And what he'll do is he'll give us a new body and a new mind, and it'll be perfect and immortal. And he'll take the essence of who we are, our soul, and our heart, and we put it into that transfigured body, and we'll live with him forever. What a promise, and how delightful that will be. During this metamorphosis time, the Bible tells us don't store up treasures on earth where the moss and the bugs can eat it, people can steal it, but rather store up treasures in heaven. You know, nobody gets to heaven except by one way, through the grace of Jesus Christ. We have to admit our sins, we have to repent, and then ask Christ to come into our hearts. But that's just the beginning. But we can store up treasures. Heaven is not a socialist place. We all can get there the same way, but once we're there, there are going to be treasures that some of us are going to store up. And how do we do that? We do that by being obedient, by following the sacraments of baptism and communion, and by being transformed by the renewing of our mind, which shapes our hearts and our souls, so that that soul will be prepared to enter that transitional body that Christ is going to give us someday at the end. And so with that, when we take the sacrament of communion, let us remember that this is a command. And let it not be just another small little service that we do, a ritual that we go through. But let us really remember that we're transforming our minds. We're renewing our spirit, our body. And in Matthew 26, he says, "And they were eating, and Jesus took the bread, he blessed and broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.'" So please take. "And then he took the cup, and he gave thanks, and he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many and the remissions of sin.'" Let's pray. Father, as we struggle to be metamorphed into the image of Christ, that we may stand before you and come to you in heaven with mountains of treasure we've built up through our sacrifices, through our compassion, our love for others, and for intense study of your word and worship, and through the devout prayer that allows the Holy Spirit to come into us. Father, we just honored you with this communion, and we ask that you take that with us and bless us throughout the new year and the new day and the new hour. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
For me, you're enough.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Father, we just thank you for this worship that we've been able to be a part of this morning. We thank you for being able to come together and to partake of the Lord's Supper and to take that bread and juice and remember the sacrifice that has been made for us. We thank you for the opportunity we've had today to lift our voices and to just praise the name of Jesus. We thank you for the fellowship that you've given us with each other this morning. And just now, as we look into your word, I pray that our minds would be laser focused and that our ears would be open and that your Holy Spirit, he would speak to us and that you would communicate to us what you want us to hear. And to not just be hearers this morning, but then to be doers and to take what you have for us and apply it to our life and become more like Jesus. And it's in his wonderful name we pray. Amen. As we begin a new year this morning, we're going to start a new series, Seeing the World Through God's Eyes. Even before New Year's hit, on social media, you could find any number of articles. 10 ways to make your new year and your life better. 15 ways to be, you know, happier and more successful in the new year. Husbands, I'll just say this, and it's free. Remember this in the new year. Happy wife, happy life, right? So as we think about a new year, I want to challenge us to not look at life and to look at this new year through the eyes of the world, because that's what we tend to do. I want us to take a different approach this morning and in this series and as we begin a new year to look at life not through the eyes of the world, but through the eyes of God. To look at life and to look at what is going on and to see it as God sees it and to approach it, you know, with the will of God in mind. You see, those who do not follow Jesus, they view the new year and they view the world in a much different way than we are called to see and to approach the new year. And so we need to refocus how we see the world. This morning we're going to look in Ephesians chapter 5, starting with verse 15. And this is what Paul writes there. Be very, very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. And so we're called to look at the world and to refocus and to see the world through God's eyes and not the eyes of the world. Even when it comes to faith, the world sees it very differently. And sometimes we conform to that and we say, God, in this new year, just, you know, please give me comfort. God, give me, you know, happiness. God, you know, just keep everything calm in my life in the new year. It doesn't preach or sell very well to tell people that we ought to be praying, God, come into my life in this new year and just wreck it. Turn it upside down. We don't like to think about that, but what if that is the very thing we need from God? For him to completely rearrange our life, to completely rearrange our priorities, to completely rearrange how we're living so that we're not living and seeing the world through the eyes of the world, but that we're living and seeing the world through God's eyes. You see, the world says a new year, it's about having more. You know, it's about having more. Get as much as you can you know, in this new year. But what if that's not the Lord's will for our life? It's not to have more. But what if the Lord's will for our life in this new year is to be content with what He has already blessed us with? The world says, you know, in the new year, here's the things that you need to do. You need to pursue happiness in the new year. And we even say that, happy new year, because we want more happiness. But what if God's will isn't so much for us to be happy, but for us to be holy? For us to be more His. We approach the new year, and again, I saw a thing on social media about how to achieve greater success in the new year. But what if God has redefined what real success is, and it's not about the things of the world, but it's about Jesus? The world says in the new year, you need to just live for every moment, and you need to just suck the most out of every moment of life in this new year. But what if God's will is that we live very intentionally with eternity always in mind? The world says when it comes to the new year, make sure that you pursue self. You know, that you focus on yourself, that you do what is best for you. But what if God's will is that we don't live for self, but we live for Jesus Christ and we live for others? And so we have to completely refocus sometimes in life to be able to look at the world through God's eyes and not our own, and not the eyes of the world. There is a parable in Matthew chapter 25. And Jesus tells it, and He says this king goes away on a long trip. But before He does, He calls in three servants, and He gives each one of them some talents. He gives one 5 talents, He gives another 2 talents, and then He gives a third person 1 talent. Now, one commentary I read this week said that a talent was equal to 20 years' wages in the Bible days. So this is not any small amount. But He gives each one talents, and He goes away on a trip, and then He comes back and He brings in the first servant to whom He gave 5 talents, and that servant had gone out and put it to work, and he had gained 5 more, and the king said, well done, thy good and faithful servant, you're going to be given even more. And he gave him his blessing. And then the one who had 2 talents, he brought him in, and he, like the first one, had gone out and had put the talents to work and had gained more. But the one who had 1 talent had gone and buried that talent in the ground. And the king described him, Jesus described him, as a wicked and lazy servant. And what he had would be taken from him, and he would be cast out where there was weeping and gnashing of teeth. Now this morning, as we think about the parable of the talents, it's not so much thinking about money and finances, but I want us to realize that we have been entrusted with the blessings of God, just as is revealed in that parable. God has entrusted us with blessings. Now, just as in that parable, we are not all entrusted equally, but we are all equally blessed. And in different ways, God has blessed each of our lives. He has created us. He has loved us. He knows us, and He has uniquely made us. And He has blessed us with unique gifts, and He has blessed us with unique blessings. And He has entrusted those with us and entrusted those to us based on how He has designed us. But you know what we end up doing? We end up comparing our blessings to other people's blessings. And it often, you know, results in jealousy. Gabe, you know, who has played drums for us in worship. I said, man, why could I not have that ability? Because I would love that. I'd be like Animal on the Muppet Show, you know, just going crazy with them. God has not blessed me with that ability or talent, and probably wisely so. each one of us have been blessed in different ways and in different degrees because we have a designer and a creator who knows us intimately and who blesses us perfectly and gifts us perfectly. One of the things that we need to do as we think about the fact that God has blessed us and has entrusted us with his blessings is we need to learn this ownership principle. It took me many years as a Christian to grasp, and I'm still working on it, this ownership principle. And it is the principle that God has entrusted us, but what he has entrusted us with does not belong to us, it belongs to him. Just as the king entrusted each of those servants with some talents and went off on a trip, they realized these are not mine, but they have been entrusted to me, and I have a responsibility for those. And God has entrusted us with his blessings, but they belong to him. Think about this, because three things that we're going to look at this morning that he's entrusted us with: our time, our tithes, and our talents. God has entrusted us with those things. They do not belong to us. Our time is not our own. Our material possessions are not our own. Our talents and gifts that we have that he has blessed us with, they don't belong to us. They belong to the Lord. And he has entrusted us with those, and he has blessed us with those. They are not ours. Now, we also see this morning then that God gives us opportunities to use his blessings for his glory. Just as the king entrusted each of the servants and then went off on a trip, he gave them an opportunity. He gave them opportunities while he was off on his trip. He gave them opportunities to decide what they were going to do with what he had entrusted them with. Two of them were faithful and obedient and took hold of those opportunities and made the most of them. The third servant was very unfaithful and disobedient with what he had been entrusted with and just went out and buried it. And so we have been entrusted, and God gives us an opportunity to use his blessings for his glory. I want us to think about, you know, each of these this morning. First time, we think about time. Imagine if someone had deposited in your bank account tomorrow morning $86,400. I don't know if there'd be anyone in here that would be disappointed if they woke up tomorrow morning and checked their online banking and found $86,400 in their account. But suppose someone, you woke up and in the morning someone had deposited that amount in your account, but there were some rules. Number one, you had to spend all of it by the end of the day, or it would be gone. And number two, you can't save it up, and you can't borrow from tomorrow's deposit. Every day, $86,400, use it or lose it. You can't borrow against it. You can't save it up. It's just there. You know, you think about how differently we would probably approach our finances. But you see, that's what God does for us every day. 86,400 seconds every day he gives us. We can't borrow against tomorrow. We can't save up today's time for tomorrow. He gives it to us every day. We all are given the same amount of time, and it really becomes, what do we do with it? How do we spend it? What are we going to do with our time? So often, I've said this, and you probably have too. I just don't have enough time. I just don't have enough time. I wish I had more time. Now, those of us that are a little bit older, and I put myself in that category, we remember the days before computers, and we thought, it's going to be just so great. Computers are going to save so much time. But how many of us sit there on our computer thinking, man, this thing is slow. If it would just hurry up. I don't think that we have a time shortage problem. I think we have a time management problem. Again, the scripture says, be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. So I don't think it's a matter that we don't have enough time. I think it's a matter that we're not using the time God blesses us with in the best way. One of the things that I'm starting in this new year, and we'll see how long I make it, hopefully for a while, but I'm going to start tracking my time every day. How am I spending it? I have a feeling that at the end of this first week, I'm going to feel very guilty about how much time I have wasted. Maybe how much time I've set and watched TV shows that I've seen 100 times. How much time I have wasted worrying and having anxiety over things that may or may not happen in the future. How much time I've wasted doing this or that. Now, please understand, there is nothing wrong with us enjoying some life and having some moments of relaxation and downtime. God created things in 6 days, and then on the seventh, he ceased from creation. And there's nothing wrong with us doing that. But could you imagine if after the second day, God said, I think that's enough for now, and I'll take a break here. And so we need to be very thoughtful about how we spend our time. Now, I'm not trying to guilt anyone this morning, but I often talk to church members. Hey, we've got Sunday school. It starts at 9:15. Oh, that's just too early. I don't have time. I can't get there. We have Bible study on Wednesday nights at 6 o'clock. Oh, if you knew my schedule, preacher, 6 o'clock Wednesday night. No, there's just, I can't squeeze that. There's just, no, I can't. I got too much going on. I don't have enough time. And so I don't want to guilt anyone into coming to Sunday school or Wednesday night, but I want to challenge us to think and to look and examine our life and to see it through God's eyes and ask ourselves, am I spending the time that God has blessed me with in the very best way? And it's not about attendance at a Sunday school or Wednesday night Bible study time. It is about using our time wisely so that God's will can be done in our life in the new year. And so there's time, and we think about that and how we're spending it, and are we making the most of it? And then secondly, wealth. That's a second blessing that God has given us that we have the opportunity to use for his glory. Wealth. Now, often I've noticed this, we often spend money in order to try and save time. I mean, how many of us, quite honestly, we will run through McDonald's drive-thru so we can save some time and we don't hesitate to pay $9 for a hamburger and some fries and a Coke. And so often we spend more money to try to save more time. And again, McDonald's is not evil. It's not a sin. But are we doing the very best with our finances that God has blessed us with? You see, we often spend more money for instant gratification to get things we don't need, things that we won't enjoy for long, and things that take up space that we don't have. I'm just continually amazed as I drive around Inglewood, and one of the things I see popping up all over the place, storage facilities. Why do we have storage facilities? Because we have no room in our garage, and we've got more stuff. And so we need to have a storage facility. Just this week we were talking, I said, man, I really need a shed. You know, I don't have a shed at my house, but I need one. I need one to put all of the Christmas stuff in it and all of the other things, just things that we have. And I need a shed, a nice big one. And then my garage. And then I think, well, then my garage would be cleaned out. But I know what would happen. I'd get more stuff and put more garage. All right, this is the first day of the new year, and so it's time for just sheer honesty. And yeah, I'm putting you on the spot this morning. How many of us have garages that don't have cars in them? Am I going to be? Okay, good. There are a few honest people in here like me, okay? We have garages, sometimes two-car garages, that, you know, we only raise the garage when no one's around and looking because we don't want people to see, you know, what's inside them. And I've often thought of taking my front garage door and just painting the front of it to look like an empty garage so that at least when people drove by, they think, man, he's got his garage together. But we buy stuff. We want stuff. We want more and more so we can have more. Because that's what the world tells us, that real success is having more and more. And so when we wake up in the morning and we look over at that treadmill that has clothes hanging on it, and we think, so glad I bought that treadmill. Where would I put my clothes? And so we want more and more stuff. But here's what I want us to think about. God has blessed us very, very richly. And so what are we doing with his blessings? I think this lesson was hit home for me the hardest when we took a group of teenagers to Jamaica and we went on a mission trip there and we met little O'Shane. O'Shane was on the beach and he was collecting crabs. And we got to talking to him and he said, this is what my family's going to have for lunch. Would you like to see my house? And so we accepted the invitation, and about a dozen of us went over to see his house. They had a little Maxwell House coffee can turned on its bottom, and they cooked a fire underneath it, and they used, you know, the top of it as a stove. He had a house that was probably no bigger than my office, one twin bed inside it, and 12 people lived there. Now, he didn't once say to me, yeah, life stinks. We don't have anything. He was very excited and happy to show us where he lived. And most of us would probably think, oh, wow, I can't imagine living like that. But I think the Apostle Paul said it best. I have learned to be content when I've had an abundance, and I've learned to be content when I've had very little. And so it's not about how much we have or how much we don't have. It's about realizing, again, it goes back to the ownership principle. Everything that I have in my life is on loan from God. And whether it's little or whether it's a lot, I have an opportunity to use it for His glory. We have made a lot of changes in our church. In 2022, our platform looks completely different. We brought on Andrew and his family to lead our worship and family ministry. And, you know, one of the realities that we see is that ministry costs money. But we realize that God has blessed us. And so we also trust in faith that He's going to bless us through the gifts and the tithes and the offerings of our church family members, and that He is going to bless us and that He is going to give us what we need to do ministry for His glory so that lives can be drawn to Jesus and transformed by the grace of Christ. But it's for His glory. See, sadly, we have preachers who stand up with a big smile on their face and tell us all, God loves you and He just wants you to be wealthy. And they preach the prosperity gospel. And that, you know, the more you give, the more God is going to give you back. And He just wants all of us to be rich and happy. And I wish that were true. But again, I don't think that God is so concerned with us being rich physically as He is about wanting to make us rich spiritually. Through His gifts, through Jesus Christ. And so how we manage our time, how we manage our wealth and our material possessions that all belong to God, again, it goes back to the scripture in Ephesians. Therefore, live. Live as wise, not as unwise, because the days are evil. And then we have this giftedness. How God has not only given us, you know, time, not only has He blessed us financially, but He also has given us gifts and talents that we can use for His glory. Now, again, I know the running joke in our church is the preacher is not a singer. And I've not been asked to do a special or to sing in the praise group, and I never will be. And so I just don't have those gifts. I don't have those talents. I'm so thankful that God has brought people to us and to our church family that have those gifts and have those abilities and have those talents. But God has uniquely gifted each one of us. In fact, Paul describes the church sometimes as a body with many parts that God has put together perfectly. One of my favorite sermons that I used to share often was on about the church being a body. And the title of the sermon was, "Don't Be an Appendix." Don't be an appendix. Now, again, I'm not a medical doctor or have much, you know, knowledge with that. But to the best of my knowledge, I don't think the appendix has any real purpose. That's why so often we have our appendix taken out. And so the message I'd often share is in the body of Christ, in the church, don't be an appendix. You see, God has blessed us with gifts and abilities and talents, and we have the opportunity to use those for His glory. Now, we can be like those first two servants in the parable of the talents, and we can use our gifts and our abilities and our talents for His glory, or we can decide to just bury those. There is a mentality, especially I think in the church in America, where it is about consumerism, where we come to church, people come to church to receive, to take, to consume. And what does the church have for me? What does the church offer me? And yet, what if God's will is not for you and for me to come to church to receive, but what if His will is for us to come to church to serve, to use those gifts and abilities that He has given us for His glory, to build up His church? When we went on the mission trip to Jamaica, I was able to use my gifts and abilities. They spoke English, and so I got to do a good bit of teaching and sharing. But a couple years later, we went on a mission trip to Haiti. No English. And we were building a church, construction. I made sure that they got one picture of me up on the roof hammering a nail in, because when it comes to construction, I'm no Bob Vila. And so when it came to construction, I guess my role the whole week was pushing a wheelbarrow full of gravel. That was about the extent of my abilities and gifts when it came to construction. But God gives each of us gifts and talents. If you're part of this church, I know God has made you and brought you here, and He has gifted you in a way that you can use those gifts to build up His church, to build up His kingdom for His glory. Sometimes it is just a matter of figuring out, how is it, God, that You've gifted me? What talents have You given me? What skills have You given me that I can use in the church? And so what becomes important is not what gift we have, but are we going to use the gifts that He's given us for His glory? Because this is the last thing we see this morning, and it's this. We will be held accountable for what we do with His blessings. In that parable of the talents, the king came back and he called each of his servants into his presence
to see what had they done with what he had entrusted them with. How had they used those talents? How had they used his blessings? Jesus said, in the same way, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. There is a day that we're going to stand before God, and how we used our time, how we used our material blessings, our money, our possessions, how we use those, how we use the gifts and talents that he's given us, we're going to give an account for that. We're going to be held accountable for how we did that. One of the poems that is often read at a funeral, I'm not going to read it this morning, is entitled The Dash. And The Dash talks about on a tombstone, there is the date of birth and there is the date of death. But what is most important is that little dash in between those two dates, how we have spent our life. And though it's just a small dash, it represents so very much. And at the end of our life, will we be pleased? And more importantly, will God be pleased with how we have spent our dash? You see, Jesus is all that matters. And if Jesus is all that matters, then we ought to be people who are living with purpose for him. And so this morning, as we think about this message and seeing the world through God's eyes and seeing how we have been blessed, how he has entrusted us with that, my prayer is that we will take some moments to examine, how am I spending my time? How am I spending the material things and the finances that God has given me? How am I using my gifts and abilities for his glory? You know, one of the things that pleases me so much is to look around at our church and to see so many who are using their abilities for his glory. Whether it is in worship, whether it is taking care of our grounds and our building, whether it is in sharing and reaching out to our community with small acts of kindness and love that represent and show the grace and love of Jesus Christ. I'm so thankful for so many of you that are using your gifts and abilities for his glory. And I want to encourage you to continue, you know, to do that. But I know this, I know that there are many of you that have been gifted. And God has given you talents and abilities. And I want to encourage you to be thinking about those in the new years and new year. And how can I use those? What ministries could I get involved in? What can I be doing here to bring God glory? As we've just had Christmas, and I've thought back over the many years of Christmas gifts that I received, even as a child, one that sticks in my mind very clearly is I loved when I opened that gift and there was an Etch-a-Sketch. Now, how many of us had Etch-a-Sketches growing up, you know? And man, you could turn those knobs and you could, you know, make all kinds of things. But then when you had completely messed everything up, you just took it and shook it. And it was a clean slate. Aren't we glad that God gives us that, not just every year, but every day? We have an opportunity to start with a clean slate. And God says, I want to do something incredible in your life. We have the opportunity to allow God to make something beautiful of our life. If we'll just completely trust him with our time, with our tithes, with our talents, if we can just say, God, these all belong to you. I belong to you. Do with them and do with me what you will. Even if it takes me out of my comfort zone. Even if it makes me step out in faith. God, let your will be done in my life. That's my prayer, not only for my life. That's my prayer for your life. That's my prayer for our church. that we will be bold and courageous in the new year, and that we will be a church that has complete faith and trust in Jesus Christ, seeking to do His will, that we might bring Him glory inside this building and out in our community. And so this morning, we're going to have a song of decision. I want you to go ahead and be standing with me this morning. Perhaps today, your first step of true faith and trust in God is to come and to take Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You could come this morning and you could say, I'm tired of doing it on my own. I'm going to put my life in God's hands and I want Jesus as my Savior. You could confess Him and turn your life over to Him. We'll baptize you. We'll immerse you into Jesus Christ this morning. And you'll have that Etch-a-Sketch moment where you come up out of the water and all your sins gone. His Holy Spirit living inside you. A new and fresh start to see what God is going to do in your life. And maybe you need to do that this morning. Maybe this morning you just need to come and you just need somebody to pray with you. You are a Christian. You are a Christ follower, but man, you need prayer this morning. You're going through some struggles, going through some hard times. You could come this morning and we'll have some folks here to pray with you. And so whatever your need is this morning, as we sing, you come if you have a need.
Amen.
Al Busonic, and we're glad that he is here with us this morning. When I first came and did a trial sermon, I got done preaching, and I didn't know Al, and Al met me in the aisleway, and I never will forget what he said to me. "Preacher, I've heard a lot of sermons in my life, and that was one of them." So love you, Al. So glad that God is working in your life and brought you through. If you are relatively new to our church and you don't have it all together and life all figured out, man, you're in the perfect place, because it's one of the things I love about our church is that God is doing a work in our life and in our church, and each day and each week his grace just pours out on us as we grow closer to one another and closer to him. And that's my prayer for this new year, that God will continue to take us together on this journey, on this adventure with him, as he continues to work in our life and shape us and mold us into what he wants us to be. And that he'll do that in such a way that, you know, again, the scripture says the days are evil. The world, so many that are lost and looking, they will see our light and not glorify us, but glorify Him. And that's our prayer for our church. I want to just give you a couple reminders of things that are coming up that you want to be a part of. Men, on January the 14th at 8:30 in the morning, right here in this place, we are having a men's breakfast. And so it's a great time to come, get some food, enjoy some fellowship and prayer with one another, and just enjoy time together as men. And so there is a sign-up sheet out at our guest center. And so, men, I just would encourage you to sign up for that and come. That'll be a great morning for us to be together. And then also, starting next Sunday morning at 9:15, Mike Schellenberger. Mike, would you just throw your hand up real quick so people can know? There you go. Mike Schellenberger is going to be leading a Sunday school class, 9:15, entitled Getting to Know ECC. And so if you're somewhat new here and you'd like to just learn more about our church and who we are and what we believe, would you see him today and we'll get you plugged into that. And it's a great class just to discover more about what God is doing in this place, who our church is and what we're about, and just a great time to meet others who are new as well. And so I want to encourage you to do that. I'm going to close us in prayer this morning, and then as we go out this morning, let's go out with a mindset that we're going to make the most of every opportunity that God gives us for His glory. Let's pray. Lord, thank You for this day that we've had together. Thank You for leading us and for Your grace in our life. We need that. And we do pray that, Father, we will be very intentional this year, this week, and even today in how we live, that we would live in a way that would be pleasing to You, that would honor You. Thank You for all the blessings You give us in life, most of all Jesus, and it's in His name we pray. Amen.